Hello all, welcome to Narayana Educational Institutions. I am Vikas from Physics Department, Narayana China Hyderabad Center. We are here today to discuss JEE Mains online paper conducted on 4th September in evening session. We are starting with question number 1. So here there are the two discs made up of same material and same thickness, just their radius is different, mass densities are same. We need to compare their moment of inertia about the axis of symmetries. So a disc, its moment of inertia of a disc is the half mr square. As their mass density and thickness is identical, I can explain it ki moment of inertia of disc 1, suppose that it is proportional to mass that will be having a proportionality with r square, and this r square again is something proportional to r power 4. If we need to calculate the ratio of the moment of inertia, that is I1 upon I2, it is simply R1 divided by R2 power 4. As we know, their ratio of the moment of inertias are something 1 by 16. This we can explain like R1 into 2 is the R2. So here this question is, most of the question, this is the based on the memory of the student. We can't claim very heavily on the options. According to their discussion here, this option would be this one, option number 2. 2 and 1 by 2 both is given. It depends on the original content of question. It was the ratio of I1 by I2 or I2 by I1. Okay, so let us go to the question number 2. This question is based on the Doppler effect. There is sound getting emitted by this car. This sound propagates towards wall, gets reflected back, and when it is getting received by receiver, initially its frequency was, actual frequency is 420, and when it is getting received by same observer who is the driver of this car, frequency is appearing as 490 to him. In the process, this car is traveling with the constant speed v towards the wall, and wall is stationary. So what we can consider here, the frequency as a standard formula, frequency received by wall and frequency emitted by wall, both are going to be the same. So what is the frequency of received by wall as a person who is stationary? We can write as the frequency, actual frequency, what is getting emitted here into C plus 0, wall is not moving at all. This person, its movement is trying to increase the frequency percepted by wall, hence you should be having the velocity of this person V here. This is the frequency received by wall as an observer. Same is going to be the frequency, it is the number of waves falling on the wall per second. Same is the number of waves getting reflected by the wall. So wall as a source, same is the frequency with which sound waves are getting emitted, you can say. It is getting released in backward direction. Now waves are traveling in this direction with C, and this person is going to pass through the waves. Frequency will get further modified for this fellow. Now this person is moving towards the against to the wave, hence a correction should be coming in a numerator here. Denominator is what? It is the effect of source, and your source is wall now and it is stationary, so there is not going to be any correction in the denominator. As a whole, final frequency, frequency final felt by this fellow is going to be this. Frequency final, which is 490 hertz This is 420 C plus V divided by C minus V. After that, just a simple calculation. You are able to see this something like this is 6 and this is 7, and then you can write 7C minus 7 of V is equal to 6C plus 6V, and at the end 13 of V is the C. Velocity V will come, speed of sound is given as 300 meter per second in the question, so it is 300 divided by 13. This is going to be the speed in meter per second, but question is demanding this is speed in kilometer per second. Hence, we can make further one more change. That is the 300 divided by 13 into 18 by 5 is going to be the speed in kilometer per hour. Okay. So, if we'll be solving it properly, you will be getting answer 83.01. The best closest answer is the option number 3. So, it is again a simple question based on Doppler effect. Let us move to the question number 3. This is the only one question in the paper based on the extra syllabus which is there in mains, which do not belong to advanced topics. And it, this question based on logic gate is looking very simple. You can attempt in many ways. One standard thing is what your entry is A here, and this is the OR gate, but not it. It is a NOR gate actually. So here at this level, this output becomes A bar, this output it becomes B bar, and this output becomes here C bar. And now again, NOR operation is getting used here. So simply what I can write here, A bar plus B bar plus C bar, and again NOR. And if we have a little idea about the Boolean algebra, we are able to understand simply this thing is becoming finally A into B into C. This is the AND operation. Your answer is the second option. But yes, if you have idea about the Boolean algebra, it is just hardly a 30-second question for you. Again, another simple thing can be done here. If you have no clear idea about Boolean algebra, why? Because the Boolean part is not there actually in your preparation in physics. It is there in mathematical induction in our 10 plus 2 standard preparation. So from mathematics side, maybe you know the Boolean parts. What you can see here very simply, to get a high output here, to get a high output, all three must be low. Meaning, if all three are zero, then only you can have a high output, high equivalent to 1. If any 1 is here high or 1, 0, 0, 1, you just consider 0, 0, 1. What is going to be the OR operation here? As 1, and as it is not it, it is going to become 0. So, to get high here, we need to have here all these 3 as 0. If any one is high here, your output is standard R is going to be high, but as it is NOR, output is going to become low. So, with that clear observation, directly I can make it, if all 3 are required as 0 to get a high here, then all these 3 here as they are noted here, their respective entries are going to be 1. You just consider all 3 as 1, here outputs are 0, 0, 0. In no other situation, if anyone is here low, your output here is going to be high, and as here it is high, there it is going to be a low output. So, I have only once time a high output where there these three are 0 and respective entries are 1 and 1 and 1. So, I think by simple observation even you are able to understand. If these three are pakka 1 and 1 and 1, then only here in entries for this particular operations are becoming 0, and then only you can have a high output. If anyone here is differing from 1, here this table will differ and output will become low output. So, this is a single question and it is the only one question in paper which is based on extra syllabus things. So, move to the next question, question number 4. This is a question based on the current electricity topic. In the given circuit, calculate the potential difference between the point A and B. These two points, this point is A and that point is B. Entry voltage here, this battery supply is 40 volt. To know the potential difference in between points A and B, I am not in need to know what things are flowing here and there. Ignoring that part, simply what I can write. What is the current in this branch considering I? I into 90 plus 10 plus 10. This is simply 40 volt. This is 100. So 0.4 ampere is the current there in the upper branch. And potential difference, hence VA minus 0.4 into resistance is 90 ohm is equal to the potential at point B. So potential at A minus potential at B is coming simply 36 volt. So option 3 will be becoming your correct answer in this particular question. Move on to the next question, number 5. Again, current electricity question, similar concept. There is almost no difference in the previous and this question. Current passing through the 4 ohm resistance. Here there are two 4 ohm resistance and this is a total separate circuit. This circuit, if you will be looking, this part here, it is separate from the upper and lower branch. So whatever potential difference you have here, 8 volt is directly getting dropped across the 8 ohm resistance. So in this branch, current is, if I will be writing 8 volt is the current I into the two resistances which are 4 ohm and 4 ohm. Current I is becoming 1 ampere. So this is the simplest question in this paper. Last question is also based on same concept. Move on to the next question. Question number 6. Variation of the force acting on a particle is given with respect to the displacement of the particle. Calculate the work done by the force in moving from x equal to 0 to x equal to 30. So the definition of the work done, dW is simply fds. Here movement is happening only in x direction. So we are writing as fdx, and force is non-uniform, hence we need to have an integration. If I have a force versus displacement plot, area under the plot is going to be the total work done by this force under course of this displacement. So simply area we are in need. This work done total is the area under the plot, and area is the just first box. If you'll be looking, it is 200 and the gap is 15, and plus something 200 and 100, that is 300 divided by 2, hence 150 into 15. So this is becoming 350 into 15. So on calculating this, option A is coming as the answer for this question. So it was again a very simple, straightforward question from the mechanics portion. Let us move to the next question. Question number 7. Here there are two capacitors. One capacitor of capacity C naught is earlier charged to potential V naught. Now the same capacitor is getting connected with a new capacitor of capacitance C naught by 2, which is totally uncharged in beginning. On connecting this, in the process there will be charge transfer from first capacitor to the second capacitor, and in the process some heat is getting released. So if I'll make a diagram here, this is the first capacitor. It is charged to some charge Q naught, suppose that in beginning, and this is the another one capacitor. This capacitance is C naught and this capacitance is C naught by 2. What is happening? We are connecting them here. On closing this switch, some charge will flow, and finally charge here is Q1, and here charge is Q2. So one thing is what, this system is a system of two isolated plates. Their net charge is going to be zero. So charge Q naught, which is the C naught, V naught in beginning, and now it is the Q1 plus Q2. Q1 is the something final potential that is the C naught of V final plus C naught by 2 of V final. This is the value of Q1, this is the value of Q2. From this simple calculation, we are able to understand that potential final is simply 2 upon 3 of V naught initial potential. Once we know final potential drop across the both, you know it should be same, we can tell about the energy things. For energy, we can write our standard, you can say, work energy theorem. Work done by external things, work done by battery, this all is the, you can say, U final minus U initial, and if any heat is there, then that heat. So actually here there is no external agency to do work, there is no other battery connected here to do work. Simply heat calculation, I can write it is the initial energy in the system minus final energy in the system. What is the initial energy? That is C naught V naught square, and final energy is half of two capacitance C naught and C naught by 2 are sharing a potential difference, that is the 2 V naught by 3. So on this simple calculation, you are getting option 3 as the answer. This is becoming answer, just we need to solve this last equation. So this is again a very simple standard question in the respective chapter. Let us move to the next question. Question number 8. Find the ratio of moment of inertia of this plate, uniform plate, rectangular plate, about the axis passing through this point O and perpendicular to the plane of board, and this axis, which is the axis passing through its center and again perpendicular to the plate. So moment of inertia about an axis passing through point O can be obtained as the M upon 12. These sides, this side is suppose that A and that is B. This side is A square plus B square. Similarly, if I'll write moment of inertia about the axis O prime, this is the moment of inertia about axis O, and after that we can go for the parallel axis theorem. That is simply plus M. This separation, if you'll be looking carefully, that is A upon 2 square plus B upon 2 square. This is the separation between the point, root of this is the separation between point O and O prime. We need ratio, moment of inertia about O prime and moment of inertia about O. This ratio when I'll be performing, this term is I naught. So on dividing it, we'll be getting 1 plus M A square plus B square divided by 4 and divided by M by 12. And A square plus B square. So just simple cancellations are required, so just simple calculation. This goes here, M goes with M, 12 in numerator and 4 in denominator. This thing is going to become 3. This is 3. Your answer is becoming 4. So here 1 by 4 is something. This should be the moment of ratio of the moment of inertia of O and O prime. Opposite is mentioned here, so it can be little bit, you can say, data issues here in the options, how they are represented. But yes, 4 or 1 by 4 is the respective ratio. Okay, so in chapter rotational dynamics, this is, you can say, one of the simplest concept. And again, this question, we can rate it as the very simple question. Let us move to the next question. Question number 9. You can consider it belongs to fluid statics or even with work energy theorem concepts. Also, you can handle this question. What is happening here? Level of the liquid in this part and that part is different. This height is x1 and this height is x2. Now, this valve is opened and we are waiting for some time. at the end level is going to become same, because at the steady state, once movement is allowed, finally you cannot have a pressure difference between these two points. These two points, their pressures are going to be similar. For that, irrespective of their areas, these heights should be finally equal. So final height, I am calling it as x. So for final height, I can make a relation, volume conservation, their areas are equal. Even if they are not equal, then also final height should be same. So here area is equal, hence your calculation will become very, very simple. Area A of x1 plus area A of x2 is the area A. 2 of x, y, x here and x there. You see, as areas are equal, this we can predict it orally also. Okay, final height is becoming x, which is the summation of the two height divided by 2, arithmetic mean. Now, the loss in the gravitational potential energy. What is the initial potential energy of system minus what is the final potential energy of system? This is our question. So, initial potential energy, I can write here what is the mass, that is the rho into A into x1 into g, this is the weight, and where is the respective center of mass? You will be telling me it is exactly midway in this height, that is x1 by 2. So looking this form, I can write the second part respective energy directly even, that is rho A g x2 square divided by 2. This is the initial energy in the system, and finally energy is the rho A g by 2. X final is what? X final is the x1 plus x2 divided by 2 square. But this is the energy only in one cylinder. I can multiply this by 2 to get the total energy in the two cylinder. So see, just common terms I have written, rho ag divided by 2 into, you can say this term is square term here for one cylinder. At the end 2 again comes because there are two cylinders. So it is just a simple calculation. If you are performing this calculation nicely, you will be finding this to be the answer. Option 1 is the answer. So move to the next question. Question number 10. This is the, you can say, simplest possible concept in chapter magnetostatics. Here there is a coil, it's a moment, magnetic moment vector is discussed. And there is a uniform magnetic field in this space. From this uniform magnetic field, this coil, its magnetic moment is making an angle 60 degree. Coil is available somewhat differently. Coil is available maybe here something like this. That's what your magnetic moment is there in this direction. So directly he have given in question what is the direction between magnetic moment vector and uniform magnetic field available in space. What he is saying, after some time this M vector, it experiences torque at this state, and there is no external agency to apply any support or work to torque. This and net force, magnetic force on it is going to be zero. This body, its center of mass cannot move, but yes, it is experiencing a torque. This M vector is naturally getting aligned towards B. When it will be parallel to B, when M vector is parallel to B vector, it will be having some non-zero kinetic energy, it will be having some angular motion, center of mass motion is nothing at that time. Okay, so we need to write simply one thing, initial state, and this is our desired final state. In these two states, our energy of the system is not getting changed. You can say in one way, due to decrease in magnetostatic interactional energy, there is coming some kinetic energy in your system. So I am considering moment of inertia of the coil is I, that is given here, moment of inertia. This is the angle, initial orientation there. This is the magnetic moment of coil, and here is the magnetic field in the system, that is 4 Tesla, uniform field. So I can write here simply concept as decrease in magnetic interactional energy is equal to gain in kinetic energy of system. So decrease in magnetic interactional energy, that I can write like something B and m final minus this b and m cos 60 is required, that is 1 by 2, and again because of minus this is becoming plus. Mod of this is the decrease in energy, magnetic interactional energy, which is equal to half of I omega square. So this thing on solving here is the b m divided by 2, simple simplifications. Omega is becoming b m divided by I power 1 by 2. So when we'll be feeding this all detail here, this is coming simply 10 radian per second is the angular speed. So this will be considered as a simple question. Let us move to the question number 11. Electrostatics. A charged particle of charge Q released in electric field, which is available only in x direction and it varies in this way. It is released from origin. Find the position when its kinetic energy again becomes zero. Kinetic energy again becomes zero, meaning is what? Work done by your this electric field on this system becomes zero. So if I'll write kinetic energy change, that you can write as the work done by your electric field force, work done by your this force. Only one force is acting on this system. So force is simply Q E naught 1 minus A x square. As it is a non-uniform force field, this integral from x equal to 0 to x equal to x, we need it 0. In question it is expressed key, what is the final x, what is the x up to which the net work done by electric field force is becoming 0. So straightforward simple question, this integral total is required as 0. We can drop these things. Simply we can think about our x. This is integral is x minus a of x cube divided by x is 0. So we don't require x as 0 because already we know that part. 1 minus a of x square. This term is 3 actually. I wrote a little wrongly. And now this will become, on taking x out, this power is 2. So your required x is simply 3 divided by a power 1 by 2. This is the coordinate where again kinetic energy is becoming 0, speed is becoming 0. Option 3 is our right answer. So proceeding to the next question, question number 12. Based on photoelectric effect, stopping potential its variation with reciprocal of wavelength. Our basic standard equations or Einstein's equation of photoelectric effect is what? Energy of incident radiation is equal to work function plus Ke max. And this Ke max gets related with the stopping potential. E times of a stopping potential is the energy of incident radiation minus work function. We want to have a plot of Vs, that is H nu, that can be expressed in terms of C, okay, divided by E minus work function divided by E. So if you'll be looking carefully, this must be a straight line with an intercept on y-axis which is equal to work function divided by E. In this equation, there is no term of the intensity. Intensity of incident radiation is not able to affect any of the term here. Particle concentration, particle density, number of photon falling per second. The term which affects here the wavelength of the radiation, or you can say frequency of radiation, and work function of substance. Nothing is changed out of three, these quantities. You know, this Hc divided by E is a standard constant. There is not going to be any change on this plot on changing intensity of radiation. So this is again will be coming in the category simplest question in the paper. We are proceeding to the question number 13. This is a particle, point mass is projected vertically upward against gravity. It is undergoing a retarding air drag force which is proportional to its mass into one constant which is K, which is positive, into square of the speed. They are asking what is the maximum possible height attained by this particle. So this particle is going to come to the rest for a moment, and after that again it will be going down. While going up, you are able to understand that weight is acting downward against the motion. At the same time, your viscous drag force is also acting downward. So once particle is moving upside, when particle is moving upside, the retarding force on it is simply this term, gravity plus kv square. So I can write retardation for particle is the g plus kv square. This is retardation. It is minus of v dv by dy something. Same thing, you can write it as negative of derivative of velocity with respect to time. Our required tool is what? They need height. So this writing, this is okay, but this is of no use. We need to work with our this form of the equation. So just simple integration is required. It is the v dv divided by g plus kv square. It is a simple question based on, you can say, integrations. This limit of integration, y was initially 0, this is the y is equal to max, and this integral goes from velocity initially as v naught and finally this velocity v to be 0. So this simple integration, I feel all of you are able to make it. This is simply becoming, if I'll write here, it will become k by 2 ln g divided by g plus kv naught square. This is equal to y. Actually, negative of this is y. So finally, this denominator goes up and numerator down. You will be managing this calculation and finding as this as answer. You can see this form there. Okay. So we are proceeding to the question number 14. Yes, maybe this question can take just 3 minutes of solving, but conceptually this question is actually very simple. So let us move to the question number 14. This is the question based on the diffraction of EM waves. Wavelength of wave is given, slit width is given. Find highest order of the minima on the both side of the central maxima. What is the situation? The slit dimension, if you know, depending on the lambda and the aperture of the slit, maybe it is a rectangular slit. In case of rectangular slit of dimension something d, the minima's their position on the screen, minima's their angular position theta comes as sine theta as n lambda by d. We are trying to know what is the minima far most away from the this central region. For that, this theta will tend to will become big and big. Finally, this thing will be tending to 1. It should not be becoming more than 1. We are able to understand it. So this n lambda by d, it should be something less than 1, or just for limiting condition, we need to solve n lambda by d is equal to 1. That is just our limiting condition. So d by lambda gives you limiting value of n. So just keep the values of d and this lambda, that is the 0.6 into 10 power minus 4 meter, and this lambda is the 6000 angstrom. This ratio is becoming simply 100. So 100th minima at the extreme and 100th minima in the lower extreme also is possible. So the highest order of the minima, actually 100th also is not possible. In reality, this 9th only is going to happen because there is an inequality here. We just solved our limiting condition. But order of minima they are asking, on the both side of the central maxima, that order is going to be simply 100. So option 3 will be the answer for this question. So if you remember this concept, it is there only for mains topics. It is not there in your advanced preparation. But yes, it is based on the simple formula. And I believe any student preparing for JEE mains will be having this idea about this formula. So this will be again considered as the very simple question. Maximum wavelength of the Lyman series photon for hydrogen is lambda, for hydrogen is lambda, then minimum wavelength of the Balmer series. So Lyman series for that n is equal to 1 goes to the Lyman series, and we need to have the maximum wavelength. Maximum wavelength belongs to the minimum energy. Minimum energy, this is n is equal to 2 level. 2 level to 1 level, respective photon released and its wavelength is known to us. That is 1 by lambda is the R into 1 minus 1 by 2 square. 1 upon lambda is the 3 by 4 into R. This is the one input. Now what you ask, minimum wavelength belonging to the Balmer series. Balmer series is this, this is the Lyman series. Balmer series, for that he is interested in knowing the minimum wavelength, meaning minimum wavelength belongs to the maximum possible energy. So maximum possible energy and tending to infinite, there to here, what is the, you can say transition and respective one photon and its energy. So that is the 1 divided by lambda prime is the R. Transition is happening to the 4 from here. 2 square actually is required here. 2 square which is becoming 4. So 1 divided by lambda prime is the R by 4. We need to just take the ratio of this and this. When you will be performing this, you will be finding your lambda belonging to this is becoming 3 lambda by 4. It is just ratio of this and this term. So question number 15 over, we are moving to the question number 16. Standard question in the chapter EM waves. Situation is what? Ki wave is electric field oscillation of the EM wave is given. This is the detail tells you ki wave is moving in positive z direction. This vector is representing the plane in which electric field is oscillating. We need to know the direction of oscillation of magnetic field and respective equation of propagation of magnetic component. So if I'll represent here something like this as x axis, this as y axis, and here is the z axis coming outside the plane of board. So our electric field respective component, if I'll represent here, electric field is oscillating something like this, I plus j. So at 45 degree from the xy axis, oscillating in xy plane, either there or after some time it is here. So if electric field is if electric field is available here, if electric field is available here and I need to have a wave propagating in the positive z direction, we know our standard detail as the E unit vector in the direction of E cross product with unit vector in the direction of B is the unit vector in the direction in which wave is propagating. So E, there we need to manage B, and B will be coming something like this, so that they are orthogonal. We know this E and B, their plane of oscillation is, they are oscillating in different planes separated by 90 degree. Their phase of oscillations are definitely, it must be same to make them a progressive EM wave. We have two scope for the B, either this one or this one. But E cross B here, it gives you correct direction of wave propagation. This one gives, if B is there here, this E cross B gives you a wrong direction of propagation. So this chance is actually wrong. Only this chance is possible, for which J component is positive and X component is negative. So first of all, argument here must be same, meaning phase of oscillation of B is exactly same as the phase of oscillation of this one. At the same time, B in it, its X component must be negative and J component must be positive. Hence option A, only one is the correct option. So let us move to the next question. 17. The circuit is switched on at t equal to 0. Find the time when energy stored in inductor is becoming 1 by n times of the maximum energy stored in inductor. So energy stored in inductor, energy in inductor is half of L I naught is I square. This is a term which cannot change. Ideally, energy in inductor is directly proportional to square of the current present in the inductor at that moment. Maximum possible current, respective energy is known to you. You want to have an energy 1 by n times of the maximum possible energy, meaning instantaneous current at this moment. Current at this moment is required as I max divided by root n, because energy should be 1 by n, hence current required is this. To satisfy this, another calculation can be done here. The current in general, this is a simple LR circuit. On closing this switch, depending on this EMFE, current is becoming EMF divided by resistance into 1 minus e power minus t by tau. Tau is the, you can say, time constant of this circuit, where tau is the L divided by R. Just we need to keep here the details. If we'll be solving this equation here, this current required is the I max divided by root n. This is the I max. This term is the I max, maximum possible current. Current tending to time infinite after closing the switch, into 1 minus e power minus t divided by L, and in numerator R. So this simple calculation, we need to perform this. On doing so, you are getting option 2 as the correct answer. Yes, there is a little of calculation, hardly, maybe it will take not more than 3 minutes. So this is again simple question. Proceeding to the next question, number 18. Intensity of the magnetization is 4 SI units belonging, respective temperature is the 6 Kelvin and the magnetic field external is 0.4 Tesla. What is the intensity of the magnetization at new temperatures 24 Kelvin and magnetic field 0.3 Tesla? So the magnetization quantity, what is saying, intensity of magnetization is related with Curie constant, B external, and divided by T, that is the Kelvin temperature. So based on this formula, we are going to solve this question. This is M2 divided by M1 is the B2 divided by B1, T1 divided by T2. This M1 goes there, feed the details and get the answer. On solving, you are getting 0.75 as the answer. So let us move to the question number 19. Match the following. Adiabatic process, during that adiabatic process, we know the heat involved in the process is becoming zero. So for this, the C is going to be a correct match. For isothermal process, temperature will not change, hence internal energy will not change. Its correct match is the A. Isochoric process is the process in which volume do not change, changes, and the work is becoming zero. The bomb A, B is going to be the answer. And then leftover is the isobaric process, for which heat involved in the process and work done in the process has same sign, either both positive or both negative. They both are non-zero. So correct match for this is D option. This D is the correct match for third. So C, A, D, B. This is our order of match. If you will be looking carefully, key 3 is the our correct key. Proceeding to the next question, number 20. Satellite is revolving around the Earth. Ratio of the orbital speed to escape speed is simply based on formula. This satellite is there very close to the Earth's surface and going in the circular orbit. So orbital speed is going to be something gm by r, where m is the mass of this planet and r is the radius of this circular spherical planet. Escape velocity is 2 of gm divided by r. So if you will be taking ratio, This ratio is root 2 or 1 by root 2. It depends. Orbital speed to the escape speed, as he is saying. Hence, 1 is going to be the answer for this question. Let us move to the next question. That is question number 21. Unit dimension based question. This term, first term is the moment of inertia, then force, then speed, E is the energy, L is the length. Moment of inertia, it is the ML square. Force, MLT power minus 2, this is the force. Speed square, that is the L power 2, T power minus 2. Energy, that is M, L square, T power minus 2, and L power 4. So, this simple thing we need to manage well. If you are looking for the M, this M is gone and you are left over with the M only. L things, if you will be managing nicely, this L square and L square is over. Here, this 2, there numerator 3 and denominator 4, so it is becoming L power minus 1. And for T, this T power minus 2 and T power minus 2 is gone. This is the T power minus 2. So, as student suggested, options are these. And you are able to see here, there are two quantities. Energy density. You can write it as half of stress into strain. Energy density. Strain is unitless and this is the stress. Whose you can say units are same as the unit of Young's modulus. So stress as well as Young's modulus, they both will have same dimensional formula. So either 1 or 3 is going to be the answer. So we are proceeding to the question number 22 now. Speed time graph of particle performing rectilinear motion is given. Find the distance traveled by the particle in 5 seconds. So, simply, I think this is speed things can be written as the derivative of the distance with respect to time is explaining you speed. So, ds is simply v dt. This integral is giving you the total distance traveled in that course of time. So, area under the curve, this is giving you the speed. Change in speed, and initially it started at 0. So 8 into 5 divided by 2 is the 20 is going to be the answer. Again, one very simple question, hardly 1 minute, not more than that. Question number 23. In displacement method of finding focal length of a convex lens, the distance of object, this is a typo here, this is the object. The distance of object from the screen, there is an object, there is a screen. This distance is given as 100 centimeters. One adjustment you made, this distance is x1 and that distance is x2. And you got a bright image there. So, after this what you have done, you have changed your lens position. Again, if you want to get the bright image there, in that course, this should be the x2 and this detail should be x1. Because for a given x1 plus x2, for a given value of x1 plus x2, there can exist only one pair of x and x1 and x2, which can give you a bright image there according to our relation 1 by x1 plus 1 by x2. Object distance, image distance, and that is the focal length. Next time, to have same focal length and to satisfy same this summation, this x1 can become x2 and this x2 can become x1. So, what happens? Another detail we came to know here after this analysis is the x2 minus x1 is 40 centimeter. So, I know x2 minus x1 as distance between two possible position of the lens as 40 centimeter. x1 plus x2 as 100. On solving this, you will be finding your x2 to be 70 and x1 to be 30 centimeters. Utilizing these two, focal length can be obtained. That focal length simply is the x1 x2 divided by x1 plus x2. So 70 into 30 divided by 100. 21 is becoming, 21 centimeter is becoming answer of the focal length of convex lens. So let us move to the question number 24. Binding energy per nucleon for this element approximately will be, binding energy per nucleon is required. Atomic mass of element is given, and for hydrogen also it is given. Mass of neutron is known to you, and one atomic mass unit respective value in million electron volt is given to you. So energy released here, we can write it as energy released in the reaction is simply your 120 times of 120.500 units mass of this, and minus of this 50 times of mass of this one, that value is 1.007. this minus we are keeping for all these extra terms also. There are 50 protons here and 70 neutrons. Mass of neutron is also given to you. That is a 70 into 1.008. Okay. This is going to be the mass defect of the system. Mass defect of system. Okay. On multiplying this whole thing to the this number 931, you are getting total energy released in the reaction. So total energy released in this process is the E, heat required energy released per nucleon, that you will be dividing by this number 120. So this will be becoming your answer. On doing so, you are getting close to 3.18 million electron volt as the binding energy per nucleon. So that's all. We have only 24 question here. One question we were not able to make it. Overall, this paper, 4th September evening paper, is looking as the simplest paper out of all the day's paper starting from 2 to 4th. This was the simplest paper. In all the paper, there are some good sequences there, based on the same particular, like in every paper there is a question based on unit dimension and on same philosophy of unit dimension. So things are not changing much. Students who are writing exam on 5th and 6th, these if you can go through the paper, these papers, maybe you can get benefited. You can see a pattern in which the questions are coming, and patterns is getting repeated in morning session, even in evening session also. So that's all for this paper. Thank you.